Good morning, everybody. My name is Tanya Perez. Like I said, I'm currently an undergraduate student at Penn. However, I recently transferred to Penn this year, so I wrote my paper on Harry Potter and analysis of virtue while I was at Miami-Dade College in Miami last year. So my paper is titled, or my presentation is titled, To Be or Not to Be Virtuous. It is a character analysis of Harry Potter and the Goblet of Fire, and it focuses on how J.K. Rowling utilizes character interactions to represent the cardinal virtues and vices within Goblet of Fire, and how this can promote moral development in her predominantly adolescent audience. So first I wanted to talk about virtue and its place in literature. So virtue and how I typically framed it for the focus of my paper was that virtue is typically known as a conformity to a standard of right or an achievable of the achievement of a particular moral excellence. It's usually associated with behavior showing high moral standards, and it's synonymous with moral excellence, goodness, and righteousness. In literature, it's usually seen in coming-of-age literature because virtue, morality, and choice are typically very big themes in coming-of-age literature. There's the term called Bildungsroman, which is usually a novel that follows a character's moral development and their education. I argue that Harry Potter can be considered a postmodern Bildungsroman because we follow Harry and how he morally develops throughout the entire series. So I consider The Goblet of Fire to be the Harry Potter series, the greatest asset of the series, because I think it is the novel that shifts the tone out of the seven. So the first three are predominantly marketed to children's literature, whereas Goblet of Fire kind of transitions the series to young adult literature with J.K. Rowling's use of an unprecedented tone of maturity in the themes that she chooses, in the diction that she uses, and the topics that she brings up, especially in Goblet of Fire, because she brings to her audience a new topic of ethical dilemmas and so that the audience has to directly confront them. Ultimately, her decisions result in a tonal evolution of this novel, which sets the foundation for the next two books. So I started off talking about the value of children and young adult literature in education. Recently, there's been a lot of focus on children's literature and young adult literature and how they can influence the moral development and the development education of a younger population. It's known that there's been that both genres are major stimulators of cognitive, emotional, and social development in children, and by using distinct topics in these books, you can directly impact a large audience of students or children in general. I argue that Harry Potter is a dynamic, thought-provoking series that transcends genres, genders, and generations. That there's a notably in Goblet of Fire that I'm going to talk about morality, and it's going to be a system of beliefs that is going to establish a choice between right and wrong, and this is going to govern behavior of predominantly an adolescent audience. I based morality and the foundation of morality on the four cardinal virtues for this purpose, and the four cardinal virtues that I'm focusing on are wisdom, temperance, courage, and justice. So my main statement throughout this was talking about that my thesis statement in my paper was that J.K. Rowling carefully crafts complex characters that are going to represent the four stoic virtues, also known as the cardinal virtues, and in order to foil these characters, she uses four other characters to represent their vices and has distinguished interactions between these characters amongst an ethical dilemma so that the reader can identify amongst themselves what is the choice between right or wrong, which will facilitate his or her moral development. So for the rest of this presentation, I'm going to focus on a character analysis of these distinct situations in which two characters take they have very distinct opinions on a particular issue. The first virtue that I talk about, I should also say that for the rest of the presentation, I'm going to talk about these virtues chronologically and individually, how they're presented throughout the text. So the first virtue that we're exposed to in Goblet of Fire is justice, and its respective vice is injustice. I chose to analyze this virtue in the context of Hermione and Ron's interaction when they're talking about SPEW, which is the Society for the Promotion of Elfish Welfare that Hermione brings up. So this scene takes place in the Gryffindor common room, and Hermione comes in and introduces Ron and Harry to her SPEW organization, and Ron's immediate reaction, he says, "Hermione, open your ears, they like it. They like being enslaved," to which Hermione immediately responds that with the short-term and long-term aims of SPEW, which are to to secure fair wages for the elves and then to also get them representation in the Ministry of Magic because they're highly unrepresented. So this interaction here, it's notable because J.K. Rowling, this is the first time that she uses two good characters, how the reader would perceive them, to take two different sides on an ethical issue. Normally, if you choose a character, let's say somebody from the Griffin, if you take Harry Potter and Draco Malfoy, usually a character would be inclined, or a reader would be inclined to side with Harry Potter for what he represents in the novels. But this time she's using two main characters that take very, they have very opposing opinions on the topic of elfish welfare. So she has this interaction between the two where Hermione definitely notices that the state of elves is not, it's not justful, it's very, they are enslaved, whereas Ron does not see it as enslavement, but rather that that is their work and that is what they are set out to do. So I used a paper called Harry Potter and the House Elf Rebellion to analyze the situation. Dr. Jessica Seymour actually wrote in her paper that this is the first time that Rowling diverts from her previous narrative strategy of using bad characters to highlight either a good decision or a bad decision. And she says that now in this situation, the reader has to decide which of the two good characters, either Ron and Hermione, is right about the situation. And this type of choice between these characters and this identification of what is right and what is wrong will facilitate the moral development of a reader to distinguish between what is just and what is unjust. Now I'm going to move on to my second virtue, which is temperance versus rashness. Temperance is often noted as the forgotten virtue, and it's also very hard to relate to certain things because it's usually only ever related to either food, sex, or drink, because that is usually what people are temperate about. But temperance is notable, and especially in the development of your moral character, because it could talk about how you regulate yourself and your emotions. So for students or children who are learning how to cope with their emotions, different things, temperance plays a vital role in that, is kind of the unsung virtue, if you will. So I used the interaction between Severus Snape and Igor Karkaroff after they attend the Yule Ball, and Igor Karkaroff comes up to Snape to show him his mark and tell him that his mark is burnt, his Death Eater mark, I believe. The Death mark is, it's becoming more prominent on his arm and it's stinging. So he confronts Snape and he says, "Severus, you cannot pretend this isn't happening. It's been getting clearer and clearer, and I can't deny that I'm getting seriously concerned." To which Snape responds that you can flee if you want, I will cover your tracks. However, I have a duty to Hogwarts and I will stay here and commit to my duty. So Snape also, I believe in the novels, especially in Goblet of Fire, isn't seen as like the type of virtue that he represents. It's kind of interesting that he is an unsung character in this specific novel and that temperance is also his unsung virtue that he represents. Because Snape has a specific temperament and how he can go throughout the entire novel and modulate how he's going to feel and how he's going to react to different situations. It would have been very easy for him to be like Karkaroff and say, "Oh, it's burning, yes, let's leave, let's let go of our students, let's leave and go into hiding." But Snape notably was like, "Oh, I have to uphold the duties that I've already given my word to." I use Angela Duckworth's, the famous author of Grit, on a paper that she wrote called, where is it? I think it's called Self-Regulation and Personal Development and Moral Development. And she talked about the use of temperance specifically in adolescence and how insinuating temperance in a young individual can facilitate their development as a person overall. She says more depth than their compulsive counterpart, that individuals who practice temperance are more adept than their impulsive counterparts at regulating their behavioral, emotional, and attentional impulses to achieve longer-term goals. Her analysis of self-control is parallel to Snape's self-control in this novel, and that's how I chose to apply it, because a reader who reads this can notice that between two bad characters, if you will, between Snape and Igor Karkaroff, that Snape upholds his values and he controlled his reaction in the situation, keeping in mind the environment that he was in and the duties he needs to uphold. The third virtue that I'm going to cover is courage, and its respective vice is cowardice. So I use the interaction between Harry Potter and Lord Voldemort when Harry is transported to the graveyard and Lord Voldemort is resurrected or is reborn, figuratively, metaphorically, all of the above. So the statements that I use first, when Voldemort is reborn and Harry is injured, he comes out and he says, "Come out, Harry, come out and play," talking about having a fight. He tells him to confront death, basically, says that, "Oh, it might be painless, you might not even recognize it." And then he says, "I would not know how that feels because I have never died." To which Harry responds that he noted within himself that he was not going to die kneeling at Voldemort's feet, and said he was going to stand up like a man and die the way his father died, even though there wasn't any other way. He said that he would die trying to save himself. In this specific instance, I think that I use Voldemort's exact words to represent how he alludes to his own cowardness, although he outwardly portrays courage in his word choice, how he's first in his actions, how he's choosing to attack a child who has a broken leg and is weak on the ground, even though he is now powerful. That shows cowardness because he's not necessarily evenly matched. And then the fact that he mentions death in his words to Harry allude that he is afraid of death, and he is actually, like, in that respect, when he's confronted with the idea of death, he is scared of it. Whereas Harry, in his whole monologue, ensures that he is only courageous. He cares not what the outcome of the situation is going to be, but he's going to try his hardest to see that he survives. I used another paper that analyzed this situation also, like the specific interaction between Harry and Voldemort, this battle, if you will. And I believe their last names were Bidinyek and Reach. They quote, "Because the Harry Potter stories are both developmentally and psychologically significant, they can be used as motivational tool to engage pre-adolescent children in discussions of moral dilemmas. In this sense, you have two characters interacting on a field over kind of life and death, and you can notably, a student, a reader, anybody, the audience of this novel, can note that Harry is very courageous in this situation where Voldemort is not, and they can choose to instill the values that Harry is using to interact with Voldemort in their own personal life. The last virtue that I'm going to talk about and its respective vice is prudence or wisdom, and ignorance is the vice. I use the interaction between Albus Dumbledore and Cornelius Fudge after they return from the graveyard and the Triwizard Tournament has been completed, and they go to Dumbledore's office and they discuss the resurgence of Lord Voldemort. So this interaction starts by Dumbledore telling Cornelius Fudge that he should start reaching out to the giants and the magical creatures that are typically against the wizards or the ones who sided with Lord Voldemort in the past, to start recruiting them to be on the wizarding side. So after Albus Dumbledore tells Cornelius Fudge that he should reach out to the giants, Fudge says, "You cannot be serious. If the magical community got wind that I had approached the giants, people hate them, Dumbledore. It would be the end of my career." You can tell that Fudge is only concerned with what his audience or the wizarding community that he served, what they would firstly think of him, and he's only thinking about his own career and his own image rather than the actual issues that are aligned. So if he had actually reached out to the giants before, maybe there wouldn't have been so many lives lost or different things like that. To which Dumbledore responds to Fudge that, "You are blinded by the love of the office you hold, Cornelius. You fail to recognize that it matters not what somebody, while somebody is born, but what they grow to be." So this analysis can show you that two characters, again, Cornelius and Fudge, that Dumbledore in this instance represents wisdom because he is noting what happens in the situation. He's noting what is best for the community as a whole. And he is also mentioning that no matter what the giants were born or what it is thought that they should become, they can be whatever they want to be, and anybody can help facilitate that. That there isn't necessarily that they are polarized to the realm of evil, so to speak. A novel discussing Dumbledore as a beacon of wisdom throughout the entire series, or I guess up until book six, as Harry's mentor and different in each book. It's actually interesting because in Goblet of Fire, we see Dumbledore take a back seat to Harry's mentors, where he's mentored by almost every other professor on his way to the Triwizard Tournament. But then at the end, Dumbledore really comes in and shows us that wisdom of how we should prepare for this upcoming long war, if you will. So I use the quote that said, "Professor Dumbledore, headmaster of Hogwarts and renowned wizard in his own right, is wisdom personified. His insights guide the development of young Harry as wizard as well as Harry as person." So if you note that Dumbledore is a beacon of knowledge, and he not only facilitates the development of Harry as a wizard by teaching him different curses, different spells, different information, he also facilitates Harry's development as an individual by teaching him other morals, other rights, and giving him advice along the way, kind of acting as a parental figure to him. So recognizing Albus Dumbledore not only as a symbol of wisdom, but as a knowledgeable advisor to Harry cements that that Dumbledore does represent wisdom, which is like the all-knowing or all-encompassing cardinal virtue for an individual who is wise, is typically prudent, or is typically temperate, just, and courageous. I concluded arguing that Goblet of Fire represents a moral handbook for adolescents and youth, that they can use it to identify with the virtues of justice, of temperance, of prudence, and of courage. And they can use these specific interactions throughout Goblet of Fire to learn from, to identify with, and to take the lessons and apply them to their own life, which would stimulate their own moral development as individuals. I believe that's it. And then I concluded saying that that there's currently not much research on the value of virtue in children's literature, especially in the series of Harry Potter. But I concluded that if readers and academics, like everybody here, start to discuss Harry Potter as a tale of virtue, then the world can consider both childhood and adolescent morality managed.